Thank you, sir. Good morning, dear friends. I'll be talking about post-refractive surgery IOLPAR calculations. So we all know that refractive surgery actually alters the corneal curvature and the shape of the cornea. And when we are doing IOLPAR calculation after LASIK or any kind of refractive surgery, it introduces error into measurement of the true corneal PAR as well as prediction of the effective lens position. So both these factors lead to underestimation of IOLPAR in eyes with previous myopic refractive surgery and overestimation of IOLPAR in previous hypermetropic refractive surgery eyes. So essentially, there are three types of errors which can cause this problem in IOLPAR calculation. First is the instrument error, second is the refractive index error, and finally, it's the formula error. So coming to the instrument error, so we all know that our keratometers measure the paracentral points at 3.2 millimeters zone, and they miss the central flatter zone, central zone. So after refractive surgery, as the central part becomes flat, so our traditional keratometers are not actually able to measure the corneal PAR accurately in this zone. And after LASIK, the cornea can have a very wide range of curvature within this central 3 millimeter zone, which these keratometers are actually not able to capture. So refractive index error, again, the keratometers and topographers only measure the anterior surface of the cornea, and then they convert the radius of curvature into diopters using the standard refractive index of the cornea. So this standard refractive index, which is traditionally used in keratometers and topographers, is 1.3375, but the actual is 1.376. So after the LASIK, the anterior curvature is flattened, and the relationship of anterior and posterior curvature is disturbed. So the use of traditional refractive index of 1.337 is actually not correct. So this also leads to overestimation of corneal PAR, which is usually, which is calculated, which is estimated as one diopter per seven diopters of refractive correction, which is quite significant, and this also leads to hyperopic shift. So both these errors, that is the instrument error and the refractive index errors, will lead to problems with measurement of the true corneal PAR. So how do we measure the true corneal PAR after LASIK? So we have various methods or formulae which can be used. The first one is the clinical history method. Then we have the contact lens over refraction method. There are topography based post LASIK adjusted keratometry formulae, central ring topography method, and the net corneal PAR measurement using topographers. So coming to the clinical history method, so if you have access to the previous history of the refractive data of the patient, this is considered to be the gold standard method. So in this method, the central corneal PAR is calculated by adding the mean keratometry PAR before surgery to the spherical equivalent before surgery, and then subtracting this the spherical equivalent, which is there after the refractive surgery. So theoretically, it yields the actual corneal PAR, and which is easy to calculate, provided the data is available. But the disadvantage is that the accuracy of data may be questionable, and there could have been interval changes in the corneal curvature and the clarity of the lens from the time frame between the LASIK and the cataract surgery. And this formula is not suitable for post-RK eyes due to progressive flattening over time. Second method is the contact lens over refraction method described by Ridley. So in this method, the corneal PAR is calculated as the sum of the base curve of the contact lens, PAR of the contact lens, and refractive over refraction minus the spherical equivalent of the manifest refraction without a contact lens. So the advantage is that the equipment is very is inexpensive. We always have contact lenses readily available, and this is suitable for post LASIK and RK corneas. The disadvantage is that the accuracy of this method worsens with a poorer visual acuity, and hence it is not suitable for mature or dense cataracts. So then we come to the topography based post LASIK adjusted keratometry formulae. These are regression formulae based on LASIK data, hence not suitable for post RK eyes. We have the Koch and Wang formula and the Shamas formula. And then we have the central ring topography method, which is suitable for post RK eyes. So in this method, we average the topographic corneal PAR of the central 3 millimeter zone, and when this is applied with a double K IOL formula, it provides excellent IOL predictability. Finally, we come to net corneal power measurement. This is done using different topographers. We have the OBSCAN and the PentaCam. OBSCAN, as we all know, is the placebo disc and scanning slit technology. The limitation of OBSCAN is that the measurement of the posterior curvature is not very reliable. And then we have the PentaCam. And OCT also can be used for this purpose. So the distinct advantage which PentaCam provides over other topographer is that it has a rotating Scheimpflug camera and it measures both anterior as well as the posterior curvatures during the 2 second measuring sequence, and it takes 25,000 data points, including the center of the cornea. So all the so this is the advantage of PentaCam over other topographers and keratometers, which miss the central part, but whereas in PentaCam, it captures the central data, which is extrapolated in other devices. So the PentaCam gives us something known as equivalent K readings or the EKR readings. So the EKR readings, basically they use information from both anterior and posterior cornea to generate a range of central corneal power values in keratometric diopters. And this output is matched as if it would have been obtained from an untreated cornea. So depending upon the EKR zone selected, this value can be used with any of the modern third or fourth generation formulae. So this also gives us a Holliday EKR detailed report, which is a new feature developed to improve the measurement of central corneal power post-refractive surgery. Now, it was found that for both myopic as well as hypopic LASIK, the 4.5 EKR zone was shown to have the highest correlation with the central corneal power, which was calculated using the clinical history method. So since we consider clinical history method as the gold standard, so this gave the highest correlation in the 4.5 millimeter zone. And this reports the EKR values from 1 millimeter to 7 millimeter zone. So traditionally, we use 4.5 millimeter zone values for the IUL power calculation. Finally, coming to the formula error. Now, IUL power calculation depends on the effective lens position, and this is something which cannot be predicted accurately before the cataract surgery. So following LASIK, we know as the curvature changes, the ELP can also be wrongly estimated as if the IOL is sitting more anteriorly, and this results in calculation of a power of the IOL which is of lower power, and then this also leads to a hyperopic surprise. So it has been estimated that 1 millimeter error in the ELP corresponds to about 1.5 diopters of change in the final refraction, which is again very significant. So there are different formulae which can be used for post-refractive surgery eyes. I'll not go into much of the details of these formula. We have the double K formula by Aramberry, which is in which we use the post-refractive surgery corneal power for the vergence or IOL power calculation and the pre-refractive surgery corneal power for the ELP prediction. So this has been found to reduce the error in the post-refractive surgery ELP calculation, and it has also suggested IOL power adjustment tables for SRKT, Hoffer Q and Holliday 1 formula. We have the Hoffer Q formula also, which is the advantage is that it is less sensitive to corneal power variation and introduces less error in the post-refractive surgery eyes than single K formulae. We also have the Hagey's L formula, which is part of the inbuilt software of IOL Master, and this is a regression based formula. It is not suitable for post RK eyes. I'll just take 2 minutes, sir. So finally, we have various online calculators which have made our life much easy, and these are very easy, handy, and fairly predictable to use. The most common and most popular formulae are the ASCR available on the ASCRS website and the APSCRS website. The one on the APSCRS website is the Barrett True K formula, which is based on the Barrett's Universal 2 formula, and it calculates a modified keratometry value for post-refractive surgery eyes, and it also provides a double K solution to address the problem of accurately calculating the corneal height when the central Ks have been altered after LASIK. So can we implant premium IOLs post-refractive surgery? So yes, it can be done if the cornea is regular and symmetric without excessive higher order abrasions. So, and we should avoid premium IOLs if there are high amount of abrasions induced by an old style laser surgery and decenter ablations. So this was a post-LASIK cataract case where we saw that the topography was very regular and there were not much abrasions. So we used the EKR, Holliday EKR values from 4.5 millimeter zone, and we also use the Barrett 2 universal formula for final IOL power calculation, and patient had a good outcome. So to conclude, in post-refractive cases, always use more than one method to measure the central corneal power and select the flattest K value. Use more than one IOL formula and select the highest IOL power obtained. It is better to edge in the direction of myopic results rather than hypropia. And premium IOLs may be considered if cornea is regular with less abrasions. However, patients should still be warned, in spite of all these considerations, they may have a residual refractive error which may need correction after the cataract surgery. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Sheetal. And I think this is a very important topic, because with time we are going to get more and more patients who have undergone refractive surgery, who come in for cataract surgery, and they need accurate correction and they expect a good refractive outcome. So these formula are very important. One of the newer advances is the IOL Master 700, which has a true K, which actually measures the true power of the cornea, both the anterior and posterior, because it's a swept source OCT, and with this you get fairly accurate. You can use this these K readings along with the Universal 2. That's what we are doing, Barrett's Universal 2, and we find that it's as good as using the EKR with the Universal 2. So right now my favorite approaches are either to use the True K from the IOL Master 700 or the EKR along with the Barrett's Universal.